This morning's gospel reading, I think, is very interesting because the person who wrote Luke was also the writer of Acts. This is the passage that we just read. So both of these, one from Acts, one from Luke, they were written by the same person. But in Luke, the story is reported with just a couple of additional details. So this comes from the gospel according to Luke, the 24th chapter. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then Jesus opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then Jesus led them out as far as Bethany. Lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. He was carried away up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple, blessing God.
Recognize them after all those years
didn't know them anymore. Most of the time, it seemed like she had completely withdrawn from them. Scriptures tell us he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. 20 years old, and after 20 years, he had never before in his life left the state of Kansas. Not once in his entire life. He had never even visited another state before the army flew him over to Iraq. Sure was different than Kansas. Because growing up in Kansas, he grew up trusting his neighbors, just implicitly trusting everyone he met. But over there in Iraq, anyone who looked like a civilian and asked for help could turn into an enemy combatant or a suicide bomber at a moment's notice. And the worst part of it was, almost all of them were good people. Almost all of them were ordinary men and women just trying to do the best that they could in life for themselves and for their children. Most of them were good people, and he knew this. And so he wanted to help them, and he wanted to trust them. And that is what made that one in a thousand who turned out to be a killer so terrifying. When he came back to Kansas, things were different. He didn't sleep right. He kept suddenly waking up scared. Sometimes he could be awake and going about his daily routine and still suddenly wake up scared, as though he had been asleep and startled awake. The worst thing was he felt disconnected. His parents, his fiance, who he was planning to marry now that he was back, he loved them. He knew that he loved them, but still, it was like there was this invisible barrier that kept them from connecting emotionally. Everything in Kansas was just like it had always been before he left. And everything was different. The life he had before, the people he knew before, it was like they had withdrawn from him. Or maybe he had withdrawn from them. The scriptures tell us that he led them out as far as Bethany. And lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. All throughout her life, over and over again, she heard how bad meth could be, how addictive it could be. And that's why when she finally smoked some with an old friend one night, she was surprised by how not terrible and not terrifying it was. It made her feel good. It made her feel happy in a way that she hadn't known. This is great, she thought. This is not a big deal. Everyone makes it out to be so scary, but this, I can handle this. I'm in control here. And in only a few years, her husband was gone, and her children had been taken from her. Her house was gone. Everything was gone. All of it gone. Meth had cost her everything. She knew it had cost her everything, and she hated it. She hated the drug. And she couldn't live without it. Every once in a while, she'd get cleaned up, get it together just long enough to be able to go and see her kids. And the way that they looked at her, like they hardly recognized her. They didn't recognize her. She wasn't the mother that they once knew. She had withdrawn inside herself her addiction. The scriptures tell us that he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. They had been forced to watch. They had been forced to watch as he was arrested, as he was put on trial. They watched as he was beaten and mocked when they put that crown of thorns on his head, when they spit in his face, they watched as the nails were driven through his hands and his feet. They watched him die on that cross. Their hearts had been torn in two. Their world had been torn in two. Their teacher, their friend, their God, he was gone. And then suddenly, in a miracle that they could hardly believe, let alone understand, he was back with them. They had him back. For 40 days, he was with them. He ate with them, and he drank with them. He walked with them, and talked with them, and laughed with them. He went fishing with them. He prayed with them. They were together again, and it was just like it had been before. For 40 days, they had their friend back. And then, the scriptures tell us, he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. He was preparing them, you see, for Pentecost. For that holy day that we'll celebrate next Sunday, when the Holy Spirit would come and the disciples would receive tongues of fire and their spirits would be set on fire. They would receive power from on high to go and proclaim the good news of the gospel to the four corners of the world. And Jesus, he told his disciples that if he didn't go, then the Holy Spirit would not come. He said, in effect, that after the resurrection, he was just too big, too much spirit to be contained in a single human body, and that soon his spirit would be set free to fill not only them, but to all those who would come to believe in his name, that soon his spirit would fill the entire world. And they understood what he was telling them. They accepted what Jesus was telling them, but still, a promise of some Holy Spirit in the future, that must have seemed such a small comfort compared to his leaving them again. How could a spirit compare to his hands, to his arms, to his face, his eyes, his smile? Standing there up on that hilltop watching as Jesus was taken up into heaven, as he withdrew from them. Don't you think those disciples must have felt like God had withdrawn from them? Don't you think that somewhere inside they must have felt just a little bit like God had abandoned them? Do you ever feel that way? Do you ever feel like God has withdrawn from you? Do you ever feel like, sure, a spiritual presence sounds good and all, but some days I would just really prefer a flesh and blood Jesus, a flesh and blood God who could smile at me and hug me and tell me that everything is going to be okay? Don't you feel that way sometimes? Don't you think that family grieving the death of one who died much too young feels that way sometimes? The man who suddenly finds himself unemployed because of downsizing or outsourcing or one of those corporate words that they use to make it sound better than it is when you're fired for no fault of your own. Don't you think that young man might feel like God has withdrawn? The woman facing the cancer diagnosis, the young man who can't come back from war, the woman facing that deep, dark addiction, the young person facing that deep, dark depression. Do you ever feel that way? Like God has withdrawn? You're not alone. See, today is Ascension Sunday. Today, we celebrate and anticipate the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. The coming of the Holy Spirit that Jesus' ascension prepared the way for. But it also marks the day when Jesus withdrew physically from the earth. And what do we do, sisters and brothers? What do you and I do when we feel that way, when we feel keenly that God has withdrawn from us? I'll tell you what I do. I will tell you what I do when I start to feel like God is just a little bit too distant, a little bit too withdrawn. When I start feeling that way, that is when I really start looking forward to spending my Sunday mornings here in this place with all of you. When I am seeking for a God who feels just a little out of reach, I look here in the Custer Community Church for God. Because the scriptures, they tell us that Jesus led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them, and while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them. Yes, sisters and brothers, the scriptures say this, but the scriptures, they also tell us that the Holy Spirit, that Christ's own Spirit, has been poured out on all believers. The scriptures, they also tell us that the church, it is the body of Christ here on earth. That right here in this place, this is where you will find the hands and the face and the smile of Jesus still visible. On Pentecost Sunday, sisters and brothers, we get the Holy Spirit. And if you understand nothing else about Ascension Sunday and Pentecost Sunday next week, I want you to understand this, that what that means is that you and I, all of us, we get to make the church together.
Amen.
We get to be the church together. We get to create a place where anyone who feels abandoned, anyone who feels like God is just out of reach, can come and they can be overwhelmed with love. They can be overwhelmed by that sweet, comforting presence of God. Here they can feel that presence and know that God is here, here in this place. We are crafting a community in Christ's name and in Christ's image where broken hearts can come and be healed. This is the good news of Ascension Sunday. Jesus did not so much withdraw from the earth as he was raised up and exploded to the four corners of the earth and exploded and filled this place to the brim and to overflowing. And now, all of us, you and me, we are his hands, his feet, his heart. Amen.
Amen.